Hey guys, it's me, Seren, back with another video. So today is the other Wednesday, which makes today Hidden Figures Day. And today's hidden figure is Mary Lucinda Cardwell Dawson, who was a leader in the campaign to promote Black American participation in and appreciation of opera, forming the Cardwell School of Music in Pittsburgh in 1927 and the National Negro Opera Company in 1941. Shout out to Paul in Pittsburgh, who told us about Mary Cardwell Dawson. Cardwell was born in 1896 in Madison, North Carolina, the second of six children. In the early 1900s, her family became part of the Black American migration from the rural South to the urban North when they settled in Homestead, Pennsylvania, an industrial suburb of Pittsburgh. Her father, J.A., and her uncle moved to Pittsburgh to work at a brickyard. Musical ability seems to have run in the family. J.A. was a leader in his church choir, and in fact, walking to worship, he'd often wrap his throat with a scarf to protect his voice. Mary received her initial musical training in the church, and later she began studying piano and organ with a private teacher named Mrs. Leafy White. She was ultimately accepted to the New England Conservatory of Music in Boston, where she would be the only Black American student in her class. She graduated with degrees in piano and voice from the New England Conservatory of Music in 1925 at the age of 31. But as she set out into the world, trying to make a name for herself as a performer, it became increasingly obvious that racism had paralyzed her career before it even began. No opera company would hire her. After traveling through Boston, Chicago, and New York seeking work, she married Walter Dawson, a master electrician that she'd met in Boston, and returned to Pittsburgh in 1927. Racism crippled Walter Dawson's job as an electrician as well, resulting in his being fired from the Pittsburgh Housing Authority because the authority had become associated with a union that disallowed Black members. He began his own business called the Dawson Electric Company, and the money he earned there went directly to supporting his wife's ambitious musical projects, one of which was the opening of the Cardwell School of Music in Pittsburgh in 1927. For the next 14 years, Dawson trained hundreds of young, often impoverished Black Americans to sing the operas. Her students included schoolchildren, laborers, and domestics who often bartered services for their lessons. Dawson also ran the school, which was located in a huge three-story Victorian home, as a de facto hotel and gathering place for Black entertainers booked to perform in Pittsburgh but barred from white-only establishments. The home became a who's who of Black elites, including the likes of Lena Horne, and also became known as the Mystery Mansion for the constant comings and goings and lavish parties thrown at the residence. The Dawson Electric Company was also located in the same building. Dawson directed a 500-voice ensemble, which won national awards in 1935 and 1937. In 1939, her students performed at the New York's World Fair, and by 1940, students attending the Cardwell Dawson School could take classes on anything from diction to play directing, in addition to the traditional piano, violin, and voice lessons. In 1940, Dawson became president of the National Organization of Negro Musicians, and after presenting the opera Aida at the National Organization of Negro Musicians Convention of 1941, Dawson launched her National Negro Opera Company. The Aida performance received rave reviews. "We have rarely heard so impressive a chorus in all our opera experience," said the Pittsburgh Sun-Telegram. The Pittsburgh Courier also wrote, "It wasn't simply a good for Negroes opera. It was a show that might have roused Verdi himself. You must see and hear this opera." One of the organization's first victories involved Lillian Avanti, an already established Black soprano in Europe who was repeatedly rejected by all white opera companies in the United States. Avanti finally launched her U.S. career as Violetta in the 1943 National Negro Opera Company production of La Traviata. Avanti performed on a floating stage in Washington, D.C., and after her performance, Avanti would eventually join the New York Metropolitan Opera. The NNOC provided similar opportunities for countless other Black American opera performers when few other options existed. Throughout the 1940s, Dawson, with the help of former students O. Labrice Casson Beckham and Peggy Pierce Freeman, presented highly acclaimed productions of Carmen and Faust. The production Oanga was composed by Black composer Clarence Cameron Wright and The Ordering of Moses by Black composer R. Nathaniel Dett. The Ordering of Moses became the bread and butter of the National Negro Opera Company. It was given at Carnegie Hall in 1951 in a production so lavish that a florist and chemist created an unconsumable burning bush especially for the occasion. The rented costumes alone were valued at $150,000, the modern equivalent of $1.3 million. But the performance wasn't all flash. The State Department actually broadcast the performance internationally on Voice of America, and the Pittsburgh Courier wrote, "This marks the first time such an event has been scheduled for worldwide broadcasting and is a recognition of the importance the State Department attaches to the Negro's contribution to American musical life." Unfortunately, however, such lavish productions cost money that the National Negro Opera Company did not have. Mary Dawson didn't have access to the kinds of privileged patrons and economic elites that a white opera company like the Met did. So she scraped along for years, her artistic ambitions continually challenged by the NNOC's financial instability. The company didn't own a theater or costumes or sets or music, so every time they performed, they had to be rented. In addition, Mary refused to play in small or segregated halls, and these criteria limited her venue options considerably. Against immense financial odds, but with dedicated volunteers, Dawson mounted regular performances which introduced Black American audiences to opera. She organized opera guilds in Baltimore, Chicago, Cleveland, Detroit, Washington, D.C., Newark, and New York. She also worked tirelessly and creatively to fundraise. She held benefit concerts at Carnegie Hall and other venues, partnered with tap dancer Bill Robinson and musician W.C. Handy to raise money, and convinced Clark Griffith, the owner of the Washington Senators, to donate the use of Griffith Stadium to the NNOC for one night a year so they could give a benefit concert for themselves. Her legacy continued in her students. Robert McFerrin was the first Black American to perform regularly with the Metropolitan Opera, and his sons Bobby, Ahmad Jamal, and Napoleon Reed continue in the music industry in jazz and opera. Tom Douglas, a Carnegie Hall professor, created the Neighborhood Opera Company in Pittsburgh after Mary Cardwell Dawson. And Robert Pruitt, who taught at Pittsburgh's High School for the Creative and Performing Arts, was also one of the first Black performers for the Pittsburgh Opera. Despite her dedication, Mary Cardwell Dawson was unable to secure the finances to purchase insurance for the company. And when she suffered a fatal heart attack in 1962, the National Negro Opera Company folded soon after. The NNOC's original home on Frankstown Avenue in Pittsburgh is currently being renovated as a historical site. A National Negro Opera Company souvenir brochure from 1957 describes her realization as a young opera singer that her path lay not in performing, but creating opportunities for Black American performers. During intermission, she often went backstage to really observe for herself, hoping eventually to find one of her people there. Actually, she was only to be discouraged, disappointed, and finally made to wonder why the omission of her people. She thus began to wonder why she had even chosen this field for her life's work. She found the same type of exclusion existing in the Boston Symphony Orchestra, which she often attended on Fridays, as well as operas in other cities from coast to coast. Everywhere and in every respect, she found complete discrimination or exclusion. This weighed heavily upon that young student of the conservatory who vowed to start her own opera company. Mary Cardwell Dawson. A hidden figure. I'm going to have tons of links in the description box. There's also a really good documentary on her that I advise you all to watch. So hopefully you guys enjoyed this one. Hopefully everyone's having a good week and a good Wednesday. Food for thought as always. See you guys next time. Peace.